We were born in Africa, grew up here, and yet we didn't know it at all.
By the time we were 25, we knew that we had to go in search of the real Africa. Something beyond, something out there.
For us, the best way to get to know a place is to understand its top predators. Out here, that's the big cats. These are the iconic symbols of everything we think of when we hear the words wild African.
So we came out here following a dream, romance, and adventure, and we certainly found it.
Wild Africa is a place where few people belong, truly belong, but these are two of them, and this is their story. National Geographic explorers Derek and Beverly Joubert are at a new stage of their lifelong quest, living with big cats. For 25 years, the Jouberts have followed lions in Africa, trying to understand the complex relationships they have with their prey, and how that impacts on the whole environment.
Lions have to be the most chilling and most iconic of them all, a symbol of that sheer wildness. And this is what we came for.
It's all about understanding who we are, and putting that in context with the big predators on Earth.
It's a personal quest, a passion, even an obsession, in a place where just finding your subject is challenge enough.
I love this life. We get to look into the eyes of predators of death in many ways each day, and that challenges you. We get to just a few paces away, and know a few hundred lions just by sight. They're all different.
Their latest project takes them into the heart of the Okavango in Botswana, a place they have called home for many years. They have witnessed over 2,000 successful hunts. They understand that look in a lion's eyes.
We're not here to interfere or judge what they do. We've developed this non-interference ethos over the years. I try to capture the essence of the movement, not all the details necessarily.
While the visual impact of a scene like this is spectacular enough, without the sound, you can't even begin to understand what it is really like. Watch a scene without sound, for example. And now, as I'm hearing it on the day, through a powerful microphone, so we can stay at a respectable distance. Just comes alive. The reality of the moment suddenly churns your stomach with anxiety.
In the end, the entire package conveys to you, the audience, not only what it's like to be here at this moment, what we see and hear, but some of the emotions that underpin all this, even the emotions of the various animal characters in our films.
But their quest to understand the big key predators is now taking them beyond the lion prides of Africa. There are other cats here, more secretive cats, that very few people truly understand.
With this amount of lions around, it would be tricky.
Derek and Beverly will be spending the next few years of their lives searching for the most elusive of those major carnivores in Africa. They're close. Today the cat they're tracking is a leopard. Now they've found a single footprint in the sand, the real challenge begins. It's not a random art, more of a science, this tracking down of an animal.
What do you think it is?
I started taking exact measurements of the footprints of each cat. Now we can tell 26 leopards apart, just from a quick measurement.
I'm just going to follow these tracks for a moment or two.
Okay. A moment or two can mean anything up to 9 hours, which is when the sun goes down and he loses the track. But Derek is a good tracker. I have seen him go into a mode We exclude everything else in the world beyond their track and the energy of the animal he is after. There's not much that will distract him. He'll stand in one spot for an hour at a time until he can see it in the sand. The fur of a kill is what he's been looking for. He's also done enough time out here on foot to know when something like an elephant charge is serious or just posturing. He forms a picture in his mind of what happened here a few hours before. The small fragments of bone and a twig with wet blood confirms just how long ago she was here. What signs did you find out there?
Well, just here back here behind us, fresh track, but it looks like she killed a baby baboon maybe hours and more headed off that way.
I've been hearing squirrels in that direction.
Where about?
Towards the Ebony Forest.
Oh, that's a direction of the track.
It's a constant piecing together of signs, subtle clues. And this is what they've been searching for.
You have to ask, did we find her, or did she find us?
But today, they've been let in on a special secret. Finding a leopard is rare enough. Discovering a cub this age is like stumbling across a precious jewel on the forest floor. The start of a whole new chapter in their lives.
It's a small miracle for us, a daunting one at the same time, because we'll commit whatever time it takes to do the story justice.
Judging from the size and milky eyes, I place it about 10 days old. Of all the 26 leopards we could have found and followed today, just happened to be this one.
It's still steel grey eyes know only what is natural to it. The soft features of a caring mother. The safe refuge of its den. Some filmmakers in the background. A distant tree. Or just part of the scenery during these early formative days.
It's what we tried to do. Sit quietly and just fit in. We're not going anywhere. And as luck would have it, she has one very distinct spot. Right there, between the top two rows of her whiskers on her right lip. This is a cat we will recognize forever.
When cubs are left alone, they are vulnerable. This is when most cubs are killed. So the Joubert must stay back and not get too involved.
When she goes off to hunt, she moves directly to a sausage tree and enters a whole world of interactions. The nectar from the flowers attracts just about everything. Sadly for her, that includes bees. It's amazing what you can learn by just sitting and watching.
The flowers attract baboons. The leopard must now really sink back into concealment or evoke their wrath. It's a little-known fact that baboons will attack and sometimes kill leopards, using their numbers to mob them and their vicious teeth to rip them apart. Discretion and a quiet retreat are best, for now. But they're here for something else, something as sweet as the nectar of the baboon gods. And as they gorge themselves, flowers drop down to eager mouths below. There is still ample sweetness in the burgundy petals they discard. It's an intricate web that includes all life here. Today the baboons are on a sugar high and off to their next delights, leaving the impala vulnerable and focused on their own quick nibble. This is her chance.
This is an extremely efficient kill, a throat-hold, quick, and silent, very different from the big lion kills that we're used to working with.
Derek and Beverly met at high school, and after a whirlwind romance, headed off to the bush to campfires under the stars and a life under canvas. What for us may be a camping adventure is their life. The flimsy canvas wouldn't keep a lion at bay, and yet for over two decades it's been their last line of defense, and so far held up quite well. They've lost counts to other things, storms and falling trees, and once, during a drought, an elephant walked through and destroyed their home to get a single glass of water. But this is home, an office, and a place to keep some of those precious things out of the weather.
Isn't that interesting, the way that's moving?
I like the quality, which I've liked most of it.
Phil Kemp just feels like we need to work, research, write, plan books, and film. It's the most stimulating place in the world for us. And of course, it's our home.
But they're seldom alone. Because the neighbours can see predators better than they can, it's worth listening just a little more closely. Tonight, whatever it is right there. At the campfire, there's a struggle going on. A chair's been knocked over, ashes scattered.
Oh my God, you take a look at this.
It's kind of eerie, isn't it? We were just here. Eerie and beautiful at the same time.
A newborn impala, attracted to the ash of their fire, has been attacked by a 10-foot-long python. Even just after midnight, the cameras come out, the lights are set. The action, though, happens in its own time, at its own pace.
What a phenomenon of nature. This is absolutely amazing. I've always wondered how this is possible.
This is an unpredictable place, and for the Jouberts, an unpredictable life, full of extraordinary moments to capture and record in sheer wonderment.
This little impala, you see air coming out of its mouth. I'm not sure if it's the python's ear.
I think it's the impala getting trapped in the python and then coming out through its mouth.
Going days without sleep or spending hours being bitten by mosquitoes, though it may produce only a few seconds of film, in time these moments accumulate into an invaluable scientific record.
For us, it's like we're scouts or explorers of this environment.
As the python devours its prey, both whole and alive, Derek and Beverly log up yet another first for them. And it's these surprises that keep them so intensely interested in life around them.
Yeah, well, I think that's right. Not a naturally beautiful scene, but Africa's sort of made up of a whole lot of these beautiful scenes that mesh together like well-oiled cogs. And in that is the beauty of harshness.
You're totally right. Most people would be absolutely horrified to even watch this python, and yet it is so exquisitely beautiful.
It's first light. Their day starts at 4 a.m., listening to the bush.
Might as well go straight on to work.
Working with the top predators in Africa keeps Derek and Beverly on their toes day and night. But their life with leopards is about to become even more extraordinary. The cub they found when she was only 8 days old is now 6 months old. She's survived the most critical period of her life. Mother and daughter are out on a territorial patrol. As usual, Derek and Beverly are along for the ride.
These moments of mother-daughter bonding will help us create a rounded, more balanced film. People sometimes feel that all that predators do is kill, but the other social skills will help her develop into what one day will be a masterful killer. And in telling this story, I'll reach for the common ground between our species, not anthropomorphically, but looking at the obvious warmth between mother and daughter, their playfulness, and those emotions you have to know exist. These are things we all feel. It's visceral. We relate to them because we feel them too.
Thank you.
Besides, we all know what it's like to hate being washed behind the ears as a kid, and take for granted a parent's attention, as if it'd always be there. The subtle, reassuring touch of companionship.
Filmmakers' daily adventures are not always reflective moments.
Becoming a part of the system, as opposed to apart from it, is our goal, but not quite to this extent. When you can see our demise, you can see the driver's happy face. What we will spare you is the language which gets worse in proportion to the depth of the mud and the urgency of a leopard sighting. But what you cannot even imagine is the icy winter chill on the wind. This morning the temperature is quite a lot less than 30 degrees Fahrenheit. In fact, there was ice this morning, not only on the water, but among this particular crew as well. At times like this, I always feel it's better to be the wood collector, so Derek has something to place under the tires and stay well clear, and never to offer assistance. And as for advice, be warned, don't even go there. For world peace, I suggest enduring the 4 hours rather than make a suggestion that may save a few minutes. We've got the luxury of time anyway. This is a 3-year project. I just hope we don't spend most of that stuck in some box somewhere.
The more time they spend, the luckier they get. By the second year, they find the cub 85% of the time, and spend hours and hours with her each day. It's almost a daily routine for all of them. Cameras come out, always to be ready, and she barely bats an eyelid now. A lot of cleaning goes on, and she takes it all in, as usual. Daily notes are made, tapes marked. In fact, they try to make this all as casual as possible. This routine of her rather boring companions is just part of her life now. As Beverly vacates her seat to make a meal, the cub watches closely. But what she does next takes them completely by surprise. It's time for a little exploration.
It's a water bottle.
At first, they find this all quite interesting, the ultimate display of trust. And as always, they hate to interfere or to frighten the little cub. And beyond that first foray into their world, something else catches her eye.
Hey, this is getting a little bit out of control.
She's completely transformed. Inquisitive and playful, this wild leopard is suddenly interacting with them on a level they never expected. As endearing as this innocent gesture is, it suddenly worries Derek.
It's exciting to see an animal extend its trust like this. But this is so far that it takes us completely by surprise. This is a wild leopard. We've never encouraged her.
Today, something just clicked inside her brain. I wasn't fearful because she was investigating us, not a danger at all. But then Derek called it first.
It's as if she suddenly realized that we're more animated than just a vehicle. She's just comprehended that we're two living beings in here. Things just like her. She's just seen through that invisible barrier we'd like to keep between us. And this could go to a place I don't want it to.
She crossed a line, but how do they communicate that clearly without scaring her?
I'm going to just simulate the mother's growl of doing our heat. This is like a hiss, heat is blowing the air. It's
she hear a call?
She's confused.
It was a cup call. She knows she's been reprimanded. That worked.
This was the gentlest way I could think of to discipline her. The last thing we want to do is scare her off, but it's a line we don't want to cross.
Over the next few weeks, Derek and Beverly will question their core beliefs of the ethics of their profession. As they sit with their leopard, they know that something important happened here today.
I know it's crazy, but we'll seldom declare it a rain day. There's always a chance of finding a drenched cat out there.
When she was a few weeks old, there was a huge lightning strike right next to us. We thought she might associate that noise with us. But instead she ran to the car for cover. When we told the story to the guides at Mambo Camp, they named her Lachadima. It means light from the sky, or lightning.
It's a very red cat under here.
The real difference between lions and leopards is that when it's tough going, foul weather, or if they get sick, a leopard only has itself to rely on. Lions have a whole pride to take up the slack or to lie against in the cold. It's an absolute wonder that there are four times as many leopards in the world as there are lions.
We've been comparing the big cats, and at fewer than 23,000 left, lions may well disappear quite soon, much sooner than leopards. But what is certain is that at this rate of decline, I doubt either will last another 50 years.
And still, the daily work takes them deeper and deeper into the Okavango, following the big cats they are so desperate to save.
We sometimes go on the theory that if the lions can make it across, we should be able to as well. It doesn't always work, maybe 50-50 odds in a river like this. These crossings are usually quite tense.
The trick is once committed, not to hesitate, apparently.
One soft spot and we'll be stuck for hours again. Derek always says to feel his way across with the front wheels, but when we work with lions in the delta, they can hunt for hours through the stuff. It's nerve-wracking. The worst is when you see lions that are 3 feet at the shoulder and they start to swim.
Forging their way through puts them right into the action.
The big surprise here is that these magnificent full-maned lions, raging with aggression, can't always dominate the plains. Top predator chasing natural prey, you'd expect a certain result, but buffalo are not that easily intimidated. Makes you think really about that balance of power. There are a few species that can really change the environment in a major way. The lions affect everything. The health of the buffalo, the amount of grazing as a result of overgrazing, and they keep that balance. Without them, everything starts to unravel. Elephants are the other key species of Africa. They can change everything one way or the other. And I think that one needs to show that visually, the power of the ability to dominate, even the environment. When photographing elephants, Beverly often drops down low to accentuate that size, in some way, pay homage to their power.
It's emotionally hard for us when the elephants come in conflict with the lions we are following. But even then, they advance our understanding another notch.
In previous work, the Joubert's were the first to reveal to a largely skeptical scientific community that lions in some places hunt elephants with surprising success.
What we do is part adventure, part art, part science. It's why we're so balanced, or not. It's why we're so passionate, though, about what we do. It serves all sides of us.
Derek and Beverly have followed Lacedema for over 2 years, through her childhood and adolescence, but they've never seen her as bold as this. They have boundaries now. They approach carefully and film. And she uses them in case of emergencies. It's a good working relationship. And the years have seen them grow close without affecting their personal ethics and rules of engagement.
She's of little use to us for filming while underneath the vehicle. So I might as well get a shot of her at rest there. It's quite use to us getting out and moving around the vehicle. Her contact with other leopards is negligible. So when she sees that other leopard reflected in her lens, she's very interested. You can virtually see her trying to figure out how to get inside and play. It's this reflection that really holds her attention. It's all about her imaginary friend. But still, I don't like interacting like this. These moments are for those TV characters or grizzly maniacs. I prefer to keep her unadulterated by human contact.
Forced now to spend longer within the confines of their vehicle, the Joubert's have to be more inventive about their exercise. Returning to camp, the thick Okavango sand is ideal for a little walk on the wild side.
Yes, Derek puts it into low range, second gear, and off we go. The speed is just right. The sand just thick enough to keep the vehicle moving slowly in the ruts of the track. All we have to do is make sure we don't trip and fall. Getting run over in the middle of the bush, now that would be embarrassing.
Two, must be those two young males. These both lads.
The length of the Joubert's day and night vigils depend on the filming potential, or just the distance Lacedema has led them away from their camp. And sometimes, it's just easier to stay out in their vehicle for the night. And it's at times like this that the Ahs mount up and their bond with the leopard grows. They understand her moods at a glance.
Now, when it looks like she may jump down into the car, I back away. You can see the disappointment in her eyes sometimes, but we spend quite a lot of time making sure that she stays wild. We've never once reached out and touched her. You get a real sense that we could.
Yet they've reached a level where they seem to anticipate her moves. Connected in a way very few people have ever been with a wild animal.
It still feels as if we've been used to her, especially when she chooses to come to us and use us for cover.
Hyenas may steal her food, but it's the baboons that are the real threat to her. They are her nemesis, and they've spotted her. Now Derek and Beverly could get caught in the crossfire, and they have to be careful about being drawn into the conflict.
She nearly lost her life like this when she was less than a month old. We stayed nearby quietly then, even though we were watching our subject on the verge of being killed. And we'll do the same today. That doesn't stop us from hoping and praying that she'll get through it okay.
Searching for Lacedaemon yields all sorts of other gems. Male giraffe battled out for hours to the very brink of exhaustion. It's cut and thrust of a different kind. But it's also an ever-changing backdrop to what Lacedaemon sees every day. This blend of her experiences and her instincts is what we're trying to discover and find out on this project.
Predators fascinate us because we share so many of their instincts, and yet they have really hunted us for thousands of years. Certainly we are now coming to appreciate that without them, we would be much worse off. Imagine a world without lions and leopards. Out here, they are that hinge that everything pivots off.
They've lost her again, and it's becoming harder and harder to follow her as she approaches her third year and independence from her mother's territory.
What have you got there, Derek?
Looks like we've got tracks here, Lacedaemon, no problem at all.
Are they fresh, the tracks?
Fresh, yeah, a couple of hours old, maybe even less.
Derek, I'm hearing alarm calls. Just out there, I think definitely squirrels and vivid monkeys.
So that's good thing.
As usual, the forest speaks to them, conspiring to point out the leopard that everyone fears. A constant stream of insults, a litany of abuse that irritates and finally breaks her resolve to stay hidden. Lacedaemon is outed and in a mood.
We've been worried. She's alone now, away from the mother permanently. Hunting is tough for her. This is a turning point in her life.
You can just tell sometimes from that look in her eye that she means business. If I was a monkey right now, I'd be on the highest, flimsiest branch. Being on the ground is pure folly. And this is a three-dimensional game of life and death. If she succeeds, it'll be a landmark hunt. If she fails, she'll come flying out of the trees and seriously injure us.
To be here right now, to see her successes, is like going to a graduation ceremony. This is a real highlight. It is quite clear that she is going to be all right now. She has become independent. And a real leopard at last.
They've come a long way. She has been reflected in their lenses as much as they have been reflected in her eyes. And today, with this last kill, Derek and Beverly decide that it's time to wrap it all up and to edit their work to show to the world. A 3-year journey that has changed their lives.
I don't know how anybody could put an animal like this in the sights of a gun and still sleep at night. That magic spell of peace and sanctity is in the absolute stillness of nature, beyond our influence.
And we turn now to a groundbreaking new nature documentary, the first ever to trace the life of a single leopard.
And just ahead on Nightline, the life of a leopard. 3 years from cubhood to womanhood. Caught on camera in every detail.
What you're wearing. Just for the part.
Tonight, some amazing pictures of a leopard growing up. This is the story of one magnificent cat out of about 100,000 leopards in the wild.
A remarkable look at 3 years in the life of this mysterious, rarely seen cat, caught on tape like never before. You meet the husband and wife on a remarkable mission.
Looks like you're in just the right spot at the right time.
New York City with Martin Bashir.
We continue now with the husband and wife team of Derek and Beverly Joubert, following 3 years in the life of a leopard.
For some reason, we just can't let go of this project. I can smell the wild sage even at 4,000 feet above the ground. We're home.
After 6 months of editing and the release of their film, Derek and Beverly are back in their small plane, heading home, hoping to look into the eye of that leopard once again, to find the leopard the world has come to know as Lachadima. But their camp has seen some bad weather in the past few months. A lot has happened. The unusually fierce storms have continued. The camp is a wreck. Mice have moved in, and behind them, snakes. Those snakes have shed their skins, and who knows what has been happening in the bush beyond the wreckage. But they aren't back here to worry about their camp. It's Lachadima they're desperate to find.
I'm worried. We both are, actually. Lachadima is nearly full. She may have moved away by now and set up territory miles and miles away.
One single track is all I need. Just some sign.
And then something stops them in their tracks. Something shocking and unthinkable.
I just can't tell at this distance. I can't see any.
Can't be.
No. I can see from this point, Ben. It's not Lachadima. Must be a young male that wandered in here. There's still a chance that she's out there, somewhere.
At this stage, we're not even discussing how long we'll do this. We just keep going, as if we will find her one day.
It will take weeks, months, before they privately know they'll have to call it off. Each track leads nowhere. Every leopard they see, as beautiful as it is, leaves them with a sense of disappointment. Until one day, 21 days later, when a young female slowly turns her head and reveals a distinct spot in her whisker pattern. And then, as if by way of final confirmation, she comes down the tree.
Few moments in life when you know immediately that some kind of everlasting magic has just happened. This is one of them.
We were totally seduced by her, like no other animal in the wild before.
Special as she is, she's just one in 100,000, each with a similar story, each as valuable, as fragile, as desperately in need of our tolerance. The last journal entry for the project were these lines of poetry in an ancient Japanese style.
I see your wild eyes, turn soft with our reflection, a certain knowing.
We knew that we had to go in search of the real Africa. Something beyond. Something out there.
For us, the best way to get to know a place is to understand its top predators. Out here, that's the big cats. These are the iconic symbols of everything we think of when we hear the words wild African.
So we came out here following a dream. Romance and adventure, and we certainly found it.
Wild Africa is a place where few people belong, truly belong. But these are two of them, and this is their story. National Geographic explorers Derek and Beverly Joubert are at a new stage of their lifelong quest, living with big cats. For 25 years, the Joubert's have followed lions in Africa, trying to understand the complex relationships they have with their prey, and how that impacts on the whole environment.
Lions have to be the most chilling and most iconic of them all, a symbol of their sheer wildness. And this is what we came for.
It's all about understanding who we are, and putting that in context with the big predators on Earth.
It's a personal quest, a passion, even an obsession, in a place where just finding your subject is challenge enough.
I love this life. We get to look into the eyes of predators of death in many ways each day, and that challenges you. We get to just a few paces away, and know a few hundred lions just by sight. They're all different.
Their latest project takes them into the heart of the Okavango in Botswana, a place they have called home for many years. They have witnessed over 2,000 successful hunts. They understand that look in a lion's eyes.
We're not here to interfere or judge what they do. We've developed this non-interference ethos over the years. I try to capture the essence of the movement, not all the details necessarily.
While the visual impact of a scene like this is spectacular enough, without the sound, you can't even begin to understand what it is really like. Watch a scene without sound, for example. And now, as I'm hearing it on the day, through a powerful microphone, so we can stay at a respectable distance. It just comes alive. The reality of the moment suddenly churns your stomach with anxiety.
In the end, the entire package conveys to you, the audience, not only what it's like to be here at this moment, what we see and hear, but some of the emotions that underpin all this, even the emotions of the various animal characters in our films.
But their quest to understand the big key predators is now taking them beyond the lion prides of Africa. There are other cats here. More secretive cats that very few people truly understand.
With this amount of lions around, it could be tricky.
Derek and Beverly will be spending the next few years of their lives searching for the most elusive of those major carnivores in Africa.
Somebody's been down here.
They're close. Today the cat they're tracking is a leopard. Now they've found a single footprint in the sand, the real challenge begins. It's not a random art, more of a science, this tracking down of an animal.
What do you think it is?
I started taking exact measurements of the footprints of each cat. Now we can tell 26 leopards apart, just from a quick measurement.
I'm just going to follow these tracks for a moment or two.
Okay. A moment or two can mean anything up to 9 hours, which is when the sun goes down and he loses the track. But Derek is a good tracker. I have seen him go into a mode where he excludes everything else in the world beyond that track and the energy of the animal he is after. There's not much that will distract him. He'll stand in one spot for an hour at a time until he can see it in the sand. The fur of a kill is what he's been looking for. He's also done enough time out here on foot to know when something like an elephant charge is serious or just posturing. He forms a picture in his mind of what happened here a few hours before. The small fragments of bone and a twig with wet blood confirms just how long ago she was here. What signs did you find out there?
I'll just check back here behind us. Fresh track that looks like she killed a baby baboon maybe has an eye headed off that way.
I've been hearing squirrels in that direction.
Where about?
Towards the Ebony Forest.
Oh, that's the direction of the track.
It's a constant piecing together of signs, subtle clues. And this is what they've been searching for.
You have to ask, did we find her, or did she find us?
But today, they've been let in on a special secret. Finding a leopard is rare enough. Discovering a cub this age is like stumbling across a precious jewel on the forest floor. The start of a whole new chapter in their lives.
It's a small miracle for us, a daunting one at the same time, because we'll commit whatever time it takes to do the story justice.
Judging from the size and milky eyes, I'll place it about 10 days old. Of all the 26 leopards we could have found and followed today, just happened to be this one.
It's still steel grey eyes, know only what is natural to it. The soft features of a caring mother, the safe refuge of its den. Some filmmakers in the background, a distant tree, all just part of the scenery during these early formative days.
It's what we tried to do. Sit quietly and just fit in. We're not going anywhere. And as luck would have it, she has one very distinct spot. Right there, between the top two rows of her whiskers on her right lip. This is a cat we will recognize forever.
When cubs are left alone, they are vulnerable. This is when most cubs are killed. So the Joubert must stay back and not get too involved.
When she goes off to hunt, she moves directly to a sausage tree and enters a whole world of interactions. The nectar from the flowers attracts just about everything. Sadly for her, that includes bees. It's amazing what you can learn.